Hi, I'm Paul Gibbons, and welcome to Leadership Learning and the Future of Work, part of the Chief Learning Officer Symposium, and it's great to be here. I want to start by thanking a few people. First of all, the people at Human Capital Media, Malaz El Sheikh, Mike Prokopik, and Alec Odell, and also thank you to MIT for sponsoring this. It's great to be here, and thank you for listening. I know there are a lot of ways you can spend your time. None of us are blessed with hours and hours of extra time, so I'm grateful to you for listening to some of these ideas. You might not know me. I have been working in leadership development more or less since 1995. I've been a coach on and off for those 25 years at one stage. I think in 2010, CEO Magazine called me with some embarrassment, I can report this, a CEO super coach, whatever that means. I've taught executive education skills courses at the University of Wisconsin and a number of other universities. I founded in 2001 a leadership development company called Future Considerations and grew that over 10 years to almost 60 staff and associates worldwide and about $5 million in revenue. I sold the business then to staff and it continues to prosper. It's in its 20th year. And finally, I've taught leadership to MBAs, leadership and ethics. That's one of my most recent things. So the impression I'd like to leave you with is that I've come at leadership development from another number of directions, as a coach, as someone running a leadership development consulting firm, as someone teaching executive education, and as someone who's also taught MBAs. And you'll see some of that in some of the ideas that follow. Right now, I spend most of my time writing books. I wrote in 2015 The Science of Organizational Change, which was re-released in 2019. Amazon calls it a bestseller on organizational change and change management. I wrote a sequel to that called Impact, 21st Century Change Management, Behavioral Science, Digital Transformation in the Future of Work, and a book I'm going to be releasing sometime this summer or late this spring, Purpose, Mindfulness, and Meaning, The Evidence and Ethics of Workplace Spirituality. So that'll be coming to fine booksellers near you fairly shortly. The sorts of topics I'd like to cover today are the Fourth Industrial Revolution and the Future of Work, a few comments on leadership complacency, a few words on pandemic leadership, and then into maybe the body of the talk, which is thinking about leadership development in perhaps a different way, and lessons for learners, leaders, and developers. So first, the Fourth Industrial Revolution. The first industrial revolution was the steam and mechanization revolution in the 1700s, then electrification in the 1800s, which proceeded up until the earliest part of the 20th century. The third industrial revolution perhaps began in 1970 with the development of the microchip. And now people talk about the connectivity and convergence of the fourth industrial revolution. And what's that? Convergence of technologies, most significantly artificial intelligence, additive manufacturing, big data, cloud computing, augmented reality and virtual reality, Internet of Things, and human-machine interface. The World Economic Forum has some excellent resources on this, which I can draw your attention to, of all of the different dimensions for leaders and for strategists in the fourth industrial revolution. But one of the things with the fourth industrial revolution is as machines take over more and more work that was considered drudgery, and they do, in a sense, more of our thinking for us, it leaves us with the questions, what do we do especially well that machines cannot? What is the superpower of our species? And that boils down to things that we do that are distinctly human. Creativity, collaboration, visioning, working together, and dealing with complexity. Some of the leadership challenges from the fourth industrial revolution are change agility, able to implement change quickly and reliably. There are numbers around that say about today 40% of change projects struggle or fail in some respect, that's no longer good enough if you want to be a business that is able to seize opportunities and also avoid disruptions. We're turning into a data-centric businesses, so even if you work in the software, if you work in human resources, where I've done a lot of my work, you're going to have to work increasingly with data and with data scientists. You're not going to have to be a math nerd, but you're going to have to understand how to use data to make and drive decisions. Satya Nadella, one of my favorite contemporary leaders, says that the C in CEO stands for culture. Culture determines business success by, first of all, it decides how you decide. The way you make decisions in cultures, whether it's participative or whether it's authoritarian or whether it's top down or whether it's bottom up, all of that is determined by the culture of the organization. But even more importantly is culture determines what changes you can successfully implement. And one of the things I say is that if you're thinking about changing culture as part of a change program, you're thinking of it in the wrong way. That's not to say that it's not important, but shaping the culture, the cultural soil of your organization where creativity and collaboration and change happens, is not something that should be confined to a project trying to adapt the culture of the organization to a specific change project. But culture stands above that. It's something that CEOs such as Nadella recognizes. It's one of their most important things is to create a culture where change can happen. Rapid upskilling has become something that's saying the half-life of jobs today is much shorter than it has been. And that speaks to some of the things we'll talk about later, which is lifelong learning and continuous development and what some people call a deliberately developmental culture. Even senior leaders have to be techno-literate today because black boxes are dangerous, whether it's artificial intelligence or whether it's data sciences. You need to understand enough about the technology to ask hard questions. With artificial intelligence, for example, we run the risk of programming artificial intelligence, are the bots that we use, with the same human biases that plague our decision-making, with the same, for example, in human resources, with programming in some of, when we're searching CVs, some of our biases against, for example, race and gender. So we need to understand enough about the technology, even if it's very difficult technology, such as artificial intelligence and some data science technologies, enough to ensure good ethical governance of artificial intelligence. And the most human thing is critical and creative thinking, thinking in ways that machines cannot. We need to make the best use, I think, of systems thinking and complexity tools. And as Satya Nadella says, we'll conclude with this, is that every company is now a software company, which I think is a thing that is somewhat true. And then we also have to remember that Satya Nadella runs the biggest software company in the world. So he's got, as they say, a dog in the hunt. I'm going to think a little bit about leadership complacency. Is one of the things that I write a lot about is cognitive biases. And we can become, in a sense, intoxicated with our own success. We're at the tail end of the longest business expansion in history. It was the longest expansion in history, I think, 4 quarters ago, beginning in the first quarter of 2009. And you can see the growth bars there, around 3% growth, 2% growth, almost as high as 4% growth. We're now coming to the tail end of that. And the chart on the right, things are moving so quickly now, is that there have been 22 million new unemployment claims filed in the United States. The previous weekly record during the 2008 recession was 650,000. And yet we're seeing as many as 6.5 million new employment claims every week now, and the total of new employment claims is now, over the last 3 weeks, is 20 million. And if you think about that, that's the total number of jobs created by the combined Obama and Trump administrations since 2009. Those jobs have now all been furloughed or put on hold. And so it speaks to, you know, one of my things is we can't, again, become intoxicated with our own success and believe that we are somehow bulletproof and immune. And of course, that brings us to the pandemic, and you're overwhelmed, I'm sure, with information and data and statistics on the pandemic, and there's lots now being written about leadership. And I think the leadership stories from the pandemic will be being told for, you know, many years to come. This is going to be a case study in excellent leadership and in leadership that's been found wanting. One of the great messages, I think, is that with great empathy with people, you can ask for great sacrifice. And what we are finding today is that the leaders who are most able to empathize with the great suffering that we are seeing, the great human suffering we're seeing, are able to ask a great deal of their people. We need, skipping down, to supply hope and inspiration, but that hope and inspiration has to be grounded in some kind of reality. You know, Winston Churchill said, when in his famous speech when he took the premiership of Great Britain at the outset of Britain's involvement in the war, he said, "We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind." So he's not really pulling any punches. "We have before us many long months of struggle and suffering." Again, not pulling any punches. "You ask, what is our policy? I can say it is to wage war by sea, by land, by air, and with all our might and with all the strength that God can give us, to wage war against a monstrous tyranny never surpassed in the dark, lamentable catalogue of human crime." And there in those words is kind of the message, is that you don't pretend, you don't supply hope by pretending that the problem doesn't exist. You've got to sort of face the problem head on and then talk about your solutions. And Churchill's speech talks about that kind of realism. You can't centralize control in a complex system. So what we're finding is that a lot of the great innovations in leadership and a lot of the great accomplishments in the United States have been at the local level, at the state level, and the level of municipalities. Trying to control something like this from the center can't work. You can't make decisions quickly enough, and you need to make decisions that are context specific, specific to your state or to your municipality or to your city or your to particular challenges. However, leaders do have to set priorities and funnel resources. Fine words, lofty words, without action and resources and support are damaging. You need to trust experts and not make stuff up. And mistakes will be made in a complex system. When you're making decisions quickly enough, you can't suffer from analysis paralysis. You will make mistakes in judgment. All we can hope is that we can course correct quickly by taking responsibility for early misjudgments and by, as again, correcting our course and making new ones. So taking responsibility and not seeking to find blame. And one great example is the extremely charismatic and amazing leader of the New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern, who's, I think she's only 39 years old. So not only one of the few women prime ministers in the world, but also one of the youngest. And she says, it has been said of her that New Zealand isn't just flattening the curve, it's squashing it. She didn't say that. That was said of her by, I believe, the Washington Post. And so moving along from pandemic leadership, I want to talk a little bit about some of the leadership models that you can find if you look around the world. And these five, I don't want to single out, I sort of don't want to name names, although this is obviously a John Maxwell model here. One of these comes from Jim Collins, and one of them comes from Duke Corporate Education. If you look at leadership models today, I think I always find them really wanting. For example, in the Maxwell modelship, if you look at the way he conceptualizes leadership, I ask myself the question, where is strategy? Where is culture? Where is vision? When I look at the Jim Collins one, it looks like starting with highly capable individual to team member to manager to effective leader. It looks like a career progression up the greasy pole, but it begs the question, what do you have to learn to move from being a capable individual to a capable team member to a competent manager to an effective leader? What are the learning? And then we look at Duke Corporate Education, you know, a company that was ranked number one in the world for executive education for I think for decades. They look at these six dimensions of leadership, and these are all really valuable. But leadership, to my mind, is much more than just character, and leadership development requires an approach that's much more holistic than you often find running around. And so I'm going to share with you a model that I've been working with and developing based on, you know, the 25 years. You're among the first people to hear it publicly. So I offer it for criticism. You know, at the beginning of a conference, at the end of a conference talk, someone wandered up to me and said, you know, I really enjoyed your talk, but I disagreed with some of what you said. And my reaction was, wow, awesome. Because I don't think you can make non-trivial statements about complex and important topics, such as leadership development, without risking getting some things wrong. And so, you know, to imagine that I'm somehow an oracle here and able to, you know, pronounce wisdom that's unchallengeable is kind of a fantasy. It's not one I try not to delude myself with that fantasy. So I'm offering this to you as a proposal. I'm offering it to you for your challenge, for your critique, for you to really sink your teeth in and see if it adds value to your work as a leader or your work as a developer of leaders. And so here it is, a view of leadership development. So one aspect of leadership development is developing character. And we spend a lot of time, if you look at the books on leadership development that are out there, a lot of them talk about character. So what's in the box? We'll talk about that a little later, but things like authenticity and integrity and honesty and charisma, we'll go more into that later. And then there are leadership skills. And I could have divided this into two, but there's sort of business skills, which are hard skills, or planning and strategy. And then there are the human skills, which are empathy, communication, inspiration, involvement, vision, participation. Now, we'll talk more about that in a minute. And then there's something called tacit knowledge. Tacit knowledge is knowledge that's not easy to codify, to write down, to put in a model, in a book. And here we're thinking about judgment and business insight and business intuition, business theory and principles. It stands alone, but that's the sort of thing that you might get during an MBA. And then there's conceptual knowledge, just being a subject matter expert in whatever your area is. If you're an engineer and you're a programmer, it might be R, it might be Perl. If you're a marketing expert, it might be being one of the thought leaders in the marketing world. Whatever it is, it's industry specific, it's company specific, and it's function specific. If you're a human resources person, you ought to be at least competent, if not super competent, in the area, in your area of expertise. So let's talk a little bit more about these. And again, I want you to try these on as ideas. And in the time that we have set aside for questions, we'll get a chance for us to, try these on and perhaps map this onto some of your own leaders that you know and some of the your own development activities. So let's say a little bit more about each of these. First, personal development. And so I said when I founded my consulting firm in 2001 that leadership development and personal development were very close to the same thing. At the time, it was sort of an insight at the same time, and I vastly overstated the case. It was an area of leadership development that, in my opinion, was very much ignored in the early years of this century. What's in the personal development box? It's things that you read about in most of the books that are out there on leadership: accountability, resilience, authenticity, integrity, commitment, creativity, charisma, presence, self-awareness, self-mastery, emotional intelligence, values, vision, mission, empathy, care, empowerment, and leadership habits, coaching, self-management, and preparation. And one thing that we don't read enough about is, of course, leadership ethics, but it should also include that. And so that is what many of the books and what many of the consulting firms offer as the total of what their leadership development activities are. And when I ran leadership development programs in the early parts of the century, this is a lot of the stuff that we focused on. So where do you get this stuff? Coaching is very, very expensive. You get it from boutique leadership firms like mine. You get it from some executive education programs. Many of them focus just on skills, which we'll turn to in the next slide. Personal development workshops, which are very cost effective, they can be a little bit woo from the 1990s. They can be sometimes a little bit new age and a little bit out there, but they're, you know, often very effective. Transformational personal development workshops can be very effective in helping you grow in some of the areas that are described there. But personal change of the kind that we're talking about, this is deep personal change, many of these things. Many of these things, you know, we begin to inherit as traits and part of our personality and part of our comportment when we're in our, well, younger than our teens, but at least in our teens. And by the time that people are in their 20s and 30s, some of this stuff becomes fairly hardwired. I don't want to be cynical or negative about the ability to change. You know, I spent an entire career helping people learn and change and grow in these areas. But it is hard. And, you know, with self-honesty, you know, there are people who've sat in my programs, and many of my programs are 6 months and a year long, and remain, you know, largely untouched. This is not stuff that they, you know, areas in which they want to learn, particularly senior people sometimes. And there's lots in the blogosphere around these topics. But I think also there's a lot of terrible books, and one of the things I challenge in some of my books is something called pop leadership, which I think is very harmful. As one of the things I'm known for saying is, don't confuse inspiration with information. We love to be touched and moved and inspired by what we hear, but we also want to not disengage our critical faculties and think about whether that's true or whether that's useful. So let's move quickly on to skills development, and we have in that business skills, planning strategy, problem solving, performance management, operations management, change management, project management, design thinking, and agile. Well, a lot of people say, well, that's management and not leadership. I think it's leadership. I don't think leadership development can ignore management development. I don't see them as the same things, but I also don't see them as necessarily separate. And I think to develop a leader holistically, they need to have some of this stuff. You can't outsource many of these things, all of these things. And then obviously what's more normally in the skills development area are people skills, accountability, team building, people development, influencing, coaching, influencing particularly without authority when you don't have positional authority, communications, conflict, performance management, negotiation. So there's a lot in that box. And executive education programs teach this stuff very, very well, as do some boutique consulting firms. Again, university executive education can be very expensive. Boutique consulting firms, slightly less expensive. In-house learning and development teaches this a lot. I mean, many firms that insource or in-house their leadership development activities will be teaching these skills, negotiation, communications, influencing. I earned a lot of my income for the last 20 years is actually helping big organizations such as British Petroleum and Shell and HSBC Bank build up their in-house learning and development so they could upskill their people in these domains. A lot of this is learned informally by leadership modeling, and of course that's not costly. But the question is when I asked is about teenagers talking about sex, is you want to make sure that the people you're learning from know what they're talking about. When I started in leadership and management roles in the 1980s, I look back and the people around me that I were learning from were pretty unschooled and untutored and not necessarily knowledgeable. So we want to make sure, this speaks to the importance of culture, that if you have a cadre of leaders who are excellent, leadership modeling can be very effective. But if you have leaders, a culture, maybe, you know, Enron is a particular example, where leaders aren't modeling optimal behaviors, then leadership modeling can be a double-edged sword. It can either work in your favor or it can work against you. So the question is, of course, are there good leader role models in the organization from which younger leaders or emerging leaders will learn by watching what people do? And the answer is not always, for sure. Leadership skills are, I say they're very easy to get. It's very easy to go on these courses. There are entire, you know, rather large firms. I think there's one in the United States called DDS, for example, that has armies of these courses, catalogs of courses on leadership skills. However, the research shows that this stuff is very hard to transfer to the job. If you go on a three-day course, one that I used to teach was emotional intelligence, managing conflict, and the third day was negotiation. It's very hard to take that amount of learning back to your workplace and apply it relevantly and in a timely way. I mean, not just you'll forget it, but when you start to try and apply things like emotional intelligence and conflict management in context, it becomes very tricky. It needs a lot of practice, and even the best programs, you know, it's kind of like golf. You know, I mean, if you take a golf lesson and you swing a club earnestly for you know, half an hour or an hour or something like that, that doesn't even get you in the game as a golfer. But yet we expect in our leadership development programs people to practice conflict and negotiation in you know, in our classes and be able to apply that reliably back in the business. And I think that's a mistake in thinking. Tacit knowledge, practical knowledge, applied knowledge, judgment, acumen, culture, politics, relationship, decisiveness. This is the stuff that's really hard to codify and hard to teach. You get it from experience, but experience is an unreliable teacher because we're prone as human beings to believe that we know more than we do, and that to judge ourselves as having been successful when that may not entirely be the case. Peer-to-peer is another way to learn, but again, it's unreliable for the reasons I spoke about earlier. There's lots of great stuff in reading biographies and history, not just of business people, but of great political leaders and civil rights leaders throughout history. There are ways of learning some of this stuff, but it takes active reflection to learn it, and it takes honest, you know, radical candor-type reflection on your own experience. It takes having good role models around, because this stuff is perhaps the hardest of all of these things to learn reliably. And when we think about great leaders, these are some of the things that they certainly possess and certainly are things that aren't found reliably in any courses on leadership that are out there. Mentoring can be very valuable if you have a good mentor. And then coaching can support the kind of active self-critical reflection that's necessary for growing tacit knowledge. Business theory, this is the pretty standard stuff. Master's Business Administration, Strategy, Finance, Human Resources, Accounting, Ethics, Marketing, Economics, Technology. That's not an exhaustive list, but that's a sample of the sorts of things that are taught in the MBA programs I've taught in. Business schools, very expensive. The live MBAs are 50 to 100 grand, depending on where you go. Online ones, I think, can be as cheap as $25,000 or $30,000. It's still a lot of money if you're paying for it yourself. Again, it's easy to get this sort of education. You can certainly get a loan to do it, but it's hard to make it relevant. Why is that? Because I think it allows you to approach business in a holistic way. But what a manager, say a marketing manager or an accountant or a human resources professional, does day in and day out really isn't covered in an MBA. Some of it will be, if you're a human resources management, the HR part of the MBA will be deeply relevant to, but it's not until you get to a really senior level where you need this holistic cross-functional appreciation of how business works, really almost until you get to the C-suite. So the main benefit for the young people is marketability and establishing a great network and having, you know, the seal of approval from a major business school on your resume is exceptionally useful for consultants and C-level people. You see some tension is that all late 20-year-old people who are super ambitious want to get this box checked as quickly as possible. But in my opinion, they won't really get to apply it day in and day out for another decade or even 15 years or maybe never in their careers, because it's much more strategic than most day-to-day management roles encompass. And then finally, there's conceptual knowledge. Again, industry knowledge, industry trends, company knowledge, the way your company works, and functional knowledge. You get it at conferences, you get it at networking events, you get it from the trade press, some LinkedIn. Sometimes the quality on LinkedIn is, I don't think I need to tell anybody here, extremely variable from pure nonsense to sometimes some things that are very insightful. The problem is many leaders equate going on a conference, going to CIS, for example, or South by Southwest, or a trade conference, or an industry conference, as being development. And I think if you're listening to this talk, that you know that leadership development is much more than just going on a human resources conference or on a conference on R or conference for developers if you're in IT. It's much more than that. But then sometimes when I ask senior leaders how they're developing their staff and saying, well, you know, there are 12 of us going to a trade conference, or there are 12 of us going to an industry conference, or we're going to a developers conference. That's great, but it doesn't exhaust what you need to accomplish if you're interested in developing leaders. And so the messages, I think, for developers, and there's two slides of this, is there's no one place where you can get all this stuff. It comes from many different venues, and that is tricky if you're creating development plans for people. I think the personal change stuff, the personal development stuff, is easier to hire than it is to teach. And so if I could wave a wand, I would want people who are in recruitment to look at whether the personal development stuff that we talk about, the authenticity and the integrity, stuff, whether you can hire that, because it's very difficult to teach. I would rather hire somebody who had the personal development stuff sort of buttoned up, you know, we're very competent in that, and teach the technical stuff. Because if someone goes in a course on analytics or a Perl or R, they'll probably use it. That stuff's easy to teach and easy to apply. The personal development stuff's much more difficult. Tacit knowledge is very hard to develop, and I think coaching and mentoring are great tools for that. Very expensive, although many mentoring programs are mentoring programs in name only. I had a mentor in PwC in the 1990s, and I don't think I met the guy once, just because HR had rolled out this mentoring program and all of the junior consultants had to be paired with a senior consultant or a partner for mentoring. And that was the extent of their creation of a mentoring program. And needless to say, that's not enough. Many developers confuse what is easy to deliver to people with what is useful to them. There's tension between what learners want to learn and what they need to learn. An MBA is a fine example of that. And early in a career, I think, you know, you want to teach people just to learn to manage exceptionally well when they're in their 20s and early 30s, perhaps, and worry about some of the more strategic leadership stuff slightly later in their career. And then coaching is very, very expensive. It's very, very effective. It can be very, very high level. But it's, you know, with the price that you have to pay for a coach, just tens of thousands of dollars for an executive coach for a year. Developing coaching skills in the leadership population in your organization, a very high leverage thing that you can do. I don't think if you're listening to this talk, that's probably something that's obvious to many of you. I don't think I know many organizations that do this exceptionally well. A lot of organizations do it a little bit. Developers, we need integrated development planning that looks across all of those dimensions. One of the things that we refused to do at my old consulting firm was what they call sheep dip, is let's give 10,000 people the one-day course in negotiation and hope by some miracle that will, you know, increase the negotiating skills of our people who are in sales or in marketing or who are in procurement. I don't think that works terribly well. I think we need customized development. We need to create cultures of continuous self-development, make learning and growing the most exciting part of the job. And recognize too that the stuff that we did, I've got an entire chapter, an entire book on this, but how people like to learn in the 21st century. It needs to be bite-sized, you know, a 5-minute or a 12-minute or a 15-minute or 20-minute video might get shared. You might turn the people that watch that, if they really, really enjoy it and find it valuable, into people who share it with their peers and their colleagues. You can create a sort of virality inside the organization that makes the effect of this multiplicative. It needs to be just in time. You don't want it. That's one of the great things with short, bite-sized content is people can pull it towards them if they're curious or they got a problem to solve. Video and virtual often is preferred. It used to be thought that, you know, these things were second best solutions compared to live face-to-face. I don't think that's the case any longer. And it's certainly not the preference of younger workers. And tapping into people's natural curiosity and tendency to want to share content that's relevant with them. If you can tap into that, you can really highly leverage your development activities. And for learners and leaders, I think the chief executive needs to be the chief learning officer in some senses, modeling lifelong learning. Many leaders I've worked with at senior level imagine that by the time they hit the C-suite, they're fully cooked. Bill Gates used to take a week just to focus on his own personal learning, what he called Think Week. One of the most important things that leaders can do is not worry about people's current capability, but the slope of their capability. Like, I want people working for me who are growing and learning really, really quickly. And that mattered more to me when I hired than someone who had a robust portfolio of skills. I wanted people who are on an upward path, and the steepness of that path, of that development, is something that leaders can bring to people. I want a culture of growers and not knowers, is one way that I put it. People that are too busy for development is sacrificing the future of your career for I'm not sure what in the present. So if you're most comfortable doing conceptual stuff, so if you're a subject matter expert and that's your sweet spot or your spot of maximum comfort, think about doing some more personal development, this squishy stuff, the stuff that may not instantly appeal to you. And vice versa, if you're someone who's very comfortable in the personal development, the skills domain, think about ways you could make yourself more of a subject matter expert or learn some additional business theory or develop yourself in areas such as tacit knowledge. And the big message there is, of course, do what is least comfortable for you and not what is most comfortable for you when it comes to your own development. And finally, find a way to reflect either with a coach or with a mentor or with a journaling practice. The keys to the kingdom are practicing radical honesty with yourself when it comes to your own development and your own performance and constantly looking for ways to stretch yourself. So I have some additional slides, but I want to make sure we have time for questions. So let me first quickly run through where you can reach on social media, and then let's get into some questions. Thank you. And you can find me on social media. Paul at paulgibbons.net is my email. paulgibbons.net is my website. You can find me at Paul G. Gibbons on Twitter. LinkedIn is also Paul G. Gibbons, and on YouTube, I call myself Philosophy First. Thanks once again for listening. And so let's go through some of what we've learned about COVID-19 leadership qualities. Again, using the model that we've just talked about, personal development, integrity, transparency, authenticity, humility have really come to the fore. That's the governor of New York and the governor of California who've really, you know, I'm not in a position to judge, but have risen to the fore nationally as people who've done a fantastic job of communicating with integrity and humility and authenticity about the troubles they're faced. And it's actually interesting to me that Cuomo has done as well as he has, because New York's been hit worse, so it's not as if we're saying that he's done a magnificent job. People are saying that he's doing a magnificent job, because
New Zealand, they squashed the curve. It's not been the case in New York. It's been, at one stage, I think it was over half of cases in the United States were in New York City. That's no longer the case. So it's not the case that they squashed it, part of the geography of New York, part of the concentration of population. I think the epidemiologist will still be wondering why New York got hit so hard in a decade's time, something like that. But despite the severity of the crisis there, he's been thought of as being singularly excellent. Gavin Newsom in California got way ahead of the curve, way before Washington, D.C. made pronouncements about social distancing. Newsom was all over that stuff really early, and you know, many accounts has done a magnificent job, which is why if you look at California as the most populous state, has actually on a per capita basis one of the lowest incidents of COVID-19, and that's the part that Los Angeles is a lot like New York in some respects. So he's done a magnificent job in prevention, I think, the spread of the virus and being anticipating. We look at skills, the dimension of this, planning, communication, strategy, and teamworking have become important. Tacit knowledge in a complex system, so intuition, foresight, awareness, and judgment. There's not so much theory in the COVID-19 leadership qualities, but one of them is working with and engaging multiple stakeholders and understanding the mechanism of how work actually gets done. The people who've done very well, I think, are people who are on the cleverer side, are on the quickest side. They know how and when to use experts, and they understand the complexity of the interplay between medicine and economics and politics. They know enough, or they're a quick study enough, to ask the experts the tough questions and hold their feet to the fire. So those are some of the things that I think we're learning. And now, one of the things that I'd like to do with us is think of some leaders I've worked with. So I can talk you through sort of my ranking along the areas that we just talked about. And then let's try it out with a few people that you know. So Elon Musk, this is what's said of him apocryphally. I've read biographies of Musk and studied his career. He's actually one of my favorites. But in the personal development domain, certainly when it comes to things like empathy, Musk is known to be kind of a jerk on occasion. His business skills are extremely high, but he's not thought of, you know, as having a great human touch inside his organization, not by a long way. Although when you come to areas like insight and intuition and judgment and business acumen, you'll have to sort of award him something like a 5 out of 5. You know, I mean, there's an element of luck in business, but he's built, I think, 6 or 7 businesses. I mean, I think it's true to say that everything that he's touched has been a success, some of them enormously successful and some of them qualified successes. He doesn't know much about business theory, at least, you know, the sort of theory that you'd get with a PhD or in business or an MBA. He's picked up a lot along the way. He's an extremely clever guy, but he, you know, I doubt, you know, would pass a MBA level exam in marketing. He's not a great theoretician. But what he is in all of the business that he went into is he is just top of the heap. When he went into the rocketry business, he taught himself everything there was to know about rocketry. Similarly with the car business, he's an enormously self-taught nerd in all of the areas. You know, he's an engineer. And so that's an area he's strong. And so you look at that, his leader, if we were to work with him and say he was to take a leadership role that was much more stretching than his current ones or something like that, I would certainly want to work with him if I were a coach or something like that in the sort of personal development area. on the other hand, I worked with a young guy who, he was probably a decade or more younger than me. Maybe he was 23 or 25 when I was 33 or 35. And he was one of the most naturally charismatic, empathetic, naturally a good listener, naturally interested in other people, naturally resilient. And all of the sort of personal development character areas, this guy was like 10 out of 10. And yeah, I became friends with this guy, and I was always like, this guy's of a different species. He's just so naturally, you know, warm and receptive. And he had, from my point of view, this guy was definitely going to go someplace. But at the same time, he didn't have, apart from his natural abilities, he'd never gone on the courses on listening and communication and on negotiation and on conflict and on influencing. So he had sort of natural abilities there, but he didn't have any of the skills training that we deliver to people. He, I think, was possessed of a certain amount of natural judgment or something like that. We couldn't say he was exceptional. He was a young man. You can't say his business intuition was crafted, and he didn't know anything about business theory. And he didn't know, you know, he was a young fella. He didn't know anything conceptually about business. He wasn't an industry expert or a functional expert. And yet, by the time that he was 30, first of all, I think he went to do an MBA right after he left PricewaterhouseCoopers in his mid-20s. And so he addressed the sort of gaps in his development, doing for him what was the right thing. And I think he was a CEO by the age of 30. And I think he's been a CEO of a great number. I think he's probably in his mid-40s by now, and he's been the CEO of a number of companies. He's well-known, very well-known, and very well-regarded. So I think that I give myself credit for having spotted a winner early on in his career. You know, if I'd been a horse racing expert or something like that, I would have picked a future Kentucky Derby winner. I had a client who was a CTO, and he too was a CTO, so was great conceptually. In fact, one of the things that when we did 360 degree feedback from him is one of the things the engineers respected most is he was an engineer's engineer. You know, he really, really knew his stuff conceptually. He didn't know much about business theory because functionally at all. You know, that might, even a 2 out of 5 might be generous. He did have a business judgment and intuition and so forth, but his human skills were not strong. He was conflict avoidant. He was not particularly inspirational. He was not, to my mind, a great communicator. And so I was working with him as a coach, stuff like that. And our activities were focused really squarely on the skills area and the personal development area. Because he was very strong on the right hand of this table. And then I've also worked with the chief executive of a bank who, again, he was the CFO, so he was extremely strong in concepts. He'd never done an MBA, so he wasn't, it's probably too harsh a 2 because he'd been in the C-suite for, must have been in the C-suite for 15 years now. So he's picked up a lot along the way, but great acumen, great judgment, great maturity, great insight and foresight. So very strong in that area. Strongish in skills, something like that. But, you know, the sort of things that we were working on were resilience and charisma and presence and empathy and a lot of the stuff in the personal development area to help him be more charismatic and inspirational in his work. And so, you know, I have never used this model explicitly when I've been coaching or developing people before. It's a model that that's been cooking for a number of years. So this is the first time it's been codified. And, you know, now I'd like to turn it over to you and see whether you think this fits, whether it fits any high profile leaders that you know who you're working on developing, or whether it hits people who have a public profile, or whether it fits your own development. So let's have a conversation, please, about that.